Here today, I hope. And it's a drawing of a clown who has taken off his mask and is looking at it, but the face that's looking at it is also the face of the mask.
And as far as I can recall, you also, in your memoirs, say that your first ever impression of performing arts was being in a situation where you, when you saw a circus or a performer with a painted face, and that stuck in your memory.
It must have happened when I was about two. And it's a visceral memory still. It gives me goosebumps when I think of it even now. I can recall it quite distinctly. And I remember looking at it as if it was at that height up there where those red lights are. It was probably not at a height like that, because I could see this man's face clearly. And it was utterly hypnotic, utterly fascinating, and very, very scary at the same time. And I just wanted to be there with him. It could have been, as I've written, a clown or a donkey, or maybe just a garishly painted actor in one of those natak tolis that used to perform plays about magicians and so on. I'm certain it has left a mark somewhere.
For people who haven't read the book yet, first of all, shame on you. Must go and buy it immediately. But I have to warn you, it is often frighteningly candid. How do you decide what to put in and what to leave out?
I left out what I thought would not be of any interest to an average reader. I know that young actors, I hope rather that young actors will find it interesting to read, but I didn't think there would be too many others who would. And so I put in what I thought would be of relevance to young actors who want to study my case, or people who are interested in my work who want to find out a little more about me. I was careful not to give too much information, because, well, for obvious reasons. And also, I didn't want to bore the hell out of the reader. I wanted to give as much information as was necessary, and that involved every aspect. And as I said, I wrote about it for my own, as an exercise in memory. And so there was no question of self-censoring anything, or saying, hi, how can I write this? No, there was no such inhibition, and nor was I terribly afraid of hurting anybody's feelings, though I took a little care not to.
At the same time, when you were writing or thinking about different passages that you do write about, reliving memories, there are some which, even I think for a reader, are quite difficult to read. A bio account, your often selfish son, negligent husband, absent father for 3 years. How easy or difficult is it to look back and examine yourself?
It didn't prove to be terribly difficult, because I have removed enough from all those events now to be able to re-examine them. And I was able to re-examine my relationship with my father, for example, which has been, which has haunted me always. I was able to re-examine my relationship with my first wife. I was able to re-examine my relationship with my daughter. I was able to re-examine my relationship with a couple of teachers who influenced me greatly. It was catharsis. Yeah, it was. A lot of the parts I've written about Hima, my daughter, are like a letter to her. There are things I could never say to her, and I managed to say them through the book.
Urdu mein. Naseeruddin Shah sahab ke saath baith ke gufta-gu ki jaye, aur Urdu mein baat kar sakti hai, meri bat kisne ye kaha, yun kaha. Aap tasveerein describe karte hain. Aur wo बहुत हद तक शायद कहीं तस्वीरें या खामोश फिल्में सी लगती हैं. सो आपकी याददाश्त है सारी इसी तरह तस्वीरी शक्ल में?
मेरे ख्याल से, क्योंकि काफ़ी दिलचस्प किस्म की बातें हुई बचपन में. जो मेरी अम्मी की तरफ का जो ख़ानदान था, जो समझने नाम की एक जगह है मेरठ के पास, वहाँ से थे, ज़मींदार लोग थे, शिकार और सारी जो ग्रैंडियर जमाने के साथ एसोसिएट है उसका एक खात्मा सा हो रहा था. बट आई हैव सीन द लास्ट फ्यू डेज ऑफ इट. और संभव बहुत छोटी उम्र से ही मेरी विजुअल मेमोरी और मेरी ओरल मेमोरी सुनने की वो काफ़ी मेरे ख्याल से अगर कोई देख ली अल्लाह ने मुझे तो वो यही है. मैं याद कर सकता हूँ ऐसी आवाज़ें जो मैंने 50 साल पहले सुनी है, उनका उनका एक एक ग्रेन मुझे याद आता है, वो इंटोनेशन उनके याद आते हैं, उनकी बहुत से लोगों की शक्लें मुझे बहुत बहुत क्लियरली याद रही हैं. और जो 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 वाक्य गुजरे हैं कहीं ना कहीं मेरे जहन ने उनको सिनेमेटिकली ट्रांसलेट कर लिया है शायद, क्योंकि फिल्मों का असर बहुत जल्दी मुझ पर हो गया था, ड्रामे का असर उससे थोड़ी कुछ अर्से बाद हुआ. लेकिन बहुत छोटी उम्र से ही फिल्में लोग देख रहे थे और बहुत सारी फिल्में देखी स्कूल में भी और हर तरह की अमेरिकन और ब्रिटिश फिल्में हिंदुस्तानी ज़्यादा देखा. तो शायद यही वजह है कि विजुअल मेमोरी मेरी इतनी कीन है, हंगरी रादर. क्योंकि 3 साल की उम्र में या 4 साल की उम्र में देखी हुई फिल्म की भी मुझे कुछ सीन्स ऐसे याद हैं इतने एक्यूरेटली कि उन फिल्मों को दोबारा मैंने अब जब 50-60 साल के बाद देखा, आई रियलाइज दैट आई रिमेंबर्ड इट करेक्टली.
जैसे सोचते भी तस्वीरी शक्ल में हैं जब कहानी, अब खुद भी आप हिदायतकारी भी कर चुके हैं, उसके अलावा फिल्मों में अदाकारी के हवाले से भी जो भी एक प्रोसेस रहता है तो उसमें तस्वीरें ज़्यादा अहम लगती हैं आपको?
ज़ाहिर है, जिस जिन दोनों मीडियम्स में मैं काम करता हूँ, थिएटर और सिनेमा, इन दोनों में ही थिएटर में अल्फाज का ज़्यादा ही ज़्यादा अहमियत है, लेकिन सिनेमा इज़ नथिंग बट ट्राइंग टू टेल a story through pictures.
So there was a...
I don't know if I wanted somebody to make it into a film, but but it'll probably not make a bad film.
Visual memories that Sarmad just mentioned, there's also a lot of physical memories, these physical sensations that you write about, and I've noted some of them down, like being butted by a baby goat when you were a child. Having a sewing machine needle go through your finger.
Peeing on the man standing downstairs.
Peeing on your father's superior.
yes, she really won't be proud of it.
So, Gustav, your memories are associated again more with the physical rather than the verbal.
I suppose so, because as I've also described, I can recall the touch of my father's hands. Ammi's breath warmed, the dupatta on my eyes, the taste of her food, the sound of her voice. So yes, honey, it was like a caress, all these things. So I suppose I am a sensuous person. Search for that character within myself. So it does involve a great deal of practice and labor to discover the physicality of that character. But until you do that, and it doesn't happen easily, our initial choices, and I'll say this for the benefit of young actors who may be here, our initial choices are not always the right ones. We have to try out others. And it's only when you can condition yourself to start thinking like the person you're playing, then the physical characteristics come to you. That's the only way I can describe it. The blinking of the Prestige character or the manner of the Sparsh character, I did not practice them. They occurred to me over a period of time. There are other limitations when you're playing a character like Ghalib or Gandhi, because what he looked like is well known. Extremely difficult when you're playing something like Gandhi, but you so recorded his voice is known, the way he walked, the way he sat, the way he stood, etc. With Ghalib, you have a little more freedom because nobody heard him speak, so nobody knew whether he was, how tall he was, or how short he was, or whether he could sing in Jagjit Singh's voice or not. Said that this was just after I finished playing Gandhi on stage, from a young to an old age, and my Ammi's very close and dear friend watching me play, and she said, "Tum mujhe bilkul apni Ammi ki yaad dilaa rahe." That's a very interesting question you asked, Mira, because I'm sure it's true with artists of all kinds, with writers, with painters, with dancers, with singers, etc. You don't know where the influences come from. Your job is to somehow distill them into a coherent shape and use them in your work. And so, there were other people in the audience who saw the play who also met my mom. I didn't remind any of them of her. So this was something just that she perceived. And I'm sure it happens with all kinds of artists, that you really cannot pinpoint where the influence came from.
So talking about influences and inspirations, yet another golden quote from the book. I envy a horse's capacity to crack while running full belt. So.
Yeah, I always used to wonder how they can do it. It's amazing. Because we were in the school where after dinner we walked across this first field and went to line up outside the bogs. The bogs were a line of cabins along the length of the first field. And there were about 500 of us in about 20 bogs. So you can imagine the levels of anxiety that occurred when we were waiting for our turn. And then we'd go home to Ajmer, we'd go home in a tonga. And every time we went home in that tonga, the horse relieved itself on the way. It's just fantastic, man. Why don't humans have this ability?
So in most of your re-narrations or anecdotes from your early life, you seem to be awe-stricken and fascinated by the wondrous and the fantastic. And as a child too, there are anecdotes about you escaping, say, your father's wrath or your teacher's scorn, and somehow escaping into some little corner or in the dorm and acting in front of the mirror. So, when you adopted a certain style of acting or whatever, you evolved with it, the tilt was completely towards like depicting reality, and the wondrous element was sort of suppressed.
No, I had to bring that same element of wonder to very real parts I played in films like Par, in films like Nishant, Manthan, Junoon. Unless I as an actor could bring that sense of wonder into perceiving, into the way I perceived that character, I don't think I would have been able to play it successfully. In fact, there was this person who's a very little known actor in the Indian films. His name is C.S. Dubey. You wouldn't, any of you, not be able to identify the name, but he's a guy you've seen in 100 zillion Hindi movies. And he and I were sitting around on a location one day outside Bangalore in this forest and smoking together, and I had just won the national award or something like that. And Dubeji said to me, he was a little high, and he said, "Ke tum bahut acha actor samajhte ho na, ke jab tak jindagi bhar tumhari aankhon mein wo sachchai na rahe jo jab tumhari dadi tumhe batati thi ki dekho beta chand mein gudiya baithi hai aur wo tumhare liye kameez bun rahi hai." तो जिस विश्वास के साथ तुम उस वक्त चांद की तरफ देखते थे, वो विश्वास अपने अंदर कायम रखो। Greatest bit of advice I received from a person who is himself a terrible actor. I knew nothing whatsoever of Urdu poetry until I was fortunate enough to be cast as Mirza Ghalib. Then my education in Urdu poetry started. And it's only in its very basic stages yet. There was a Shammi Kapoor movie where he's trying to woo this girl in a shikara in Kashmir. And in order to do that, for some reason, he's dressed up in a big beard and a shikari wala's costume. And they start talking about shayari for no reason at all. And he says, "Ye shayar sun." And he goes into "Raati dil mein teri khoi hui yaad aayi." And the girl replies with another shayar. And then he gives another one. And this, there were four shayars that they. And then he recites the last one. She's completely floored by that, which is "Na jaane kis liye umidwar baitha hoon, ek aisi raah pe jo teri guzar bhi nahi." And then he's so happy and falls into the water and so on. I was a Hindi film addict for a few years, in the last few years of school, when I was finishing school. And I'd see every Shammi Kapoor and every Dara Singh movie. I'd also see all the Dilip Kumar movies. There weren't that many, of course. They came once in 2 years. But I said, "Wow, what beautiful poetry this is." And I had no clue who had written it. I hadn't a clue for years after that who had written it. And then everywhere I came across it, I'd say, "Well, I thank Shammi Kapoor for that." But I really think Shammi Kapoor was a star in the truest sense. He loved being a star. He loved the shenanigans that a star is supposed to, you know, indulge in. He loved the aura that was around him. He loved the romantic angle and so on. He was a much better actor, I think, than his films bear testimony to. It's unfortunate that he never did a film which will be remembered, except perhaps Tisri Manzil, which is a great movie made by Vijay Anand. Not a great movie, but it's very well made. And it's a pity he'll be forgotten. Perhaps Kishore Kumar, as an actor, another one I loved, will be forgotten too, because they never did movie and they will be remembered. An actor is remembered only through the work he did. You may be the most skillful actor in the world, able to change 10 expressions in 1 second and change your voice and change your appearance and look like this and look like that and the other. But unless you've done work which will be remembered, you're condemned to be forgotten. And that's the tragedy of a lot of actors, not only Shami Kapoor. So people don't take me seriously when I name Shami Kapoor and Dara Singh as my two favorite Indian actors. But it's true. They are.
I just stand up there and affairs did not receive any compensation for the contribution in the film.
I doubt very much if he did. If they were to pay Faisal for all the lines of his poetry they've stolen to make Hindi films titles out of, Faisal would be rolling in it.
Okay, another thing. I actually saw this interview of yours quite a few years ago. And I remember in some circles this being a bit controversial. And you do address it in the book and in detail that you said that Sholay is not a great film, in your opinion. Leaving Sholay aside, what, in your opinion, does make for a great film, and what, which, in your opinion, are, if any, great Indian films? Not necessarily Hindi, Indian.
I would think a great film is one which says something to me and makes me feel I could not have put it in this way. I think that's true of great poetry also. That's true of great writing also. That, yeah, I know what you mean, but I could never have put it this way. It's the effectiveness of the communication that is intended via a movie. Secondly, I would think a great movie is one which accurately captures the spirit of its times. And I never tire of saying this, that it's our responsibility to make movies, and to any young filmmakers who may be here, it's your responsibility to make movies which reflect the times you live in. Because cinema is the only medium which can do that. In every other medium, you must resort to abstraction sooner or later to make your point, to make a point which is larger than just about a few people. Cinema can capture life as it is. It's also, as you all know, a combination of many other art forms. It's a combination of photography and painting and sculpture and music and ballet and dance and everything, drama included. But that is why I consider it my responsibility to be part of movies which accurately reflect the times, whether they're made in India or Pakistan or America or Scandinavia or anywhere, but movies which actually talk about it. And I don't think Sholay meets those requirements on any level. Apart from the fact that it's plagiarized from about 2,500 films. There is not an original scene in that film. And it's amazing how we have all swallowed that film. It's releasing here with great fanfare, by the way. Please go and see it. Sholay. I would say a film like Pyasa, by Gurudath. Shantaram's early movies, the ones he made about Midori marriage, about child brides, and so on, in the 40s. They're very probably not known at all over here. Then there was some of the movies of Bimal Roy, I would say, Dobi Ghazami is a great movie. Mughal-e Azam is certainly a great movie. And my favorite Hindi movie of all time is for Tisri Manzil.
You
haven't
mentioned any of your own films.
Masood. It's a hell of a lot of movies, it's a television series. But it's certainly one of my favorites. It's too it's too heavy a burden to carry, you know. To be considered that. Well, thank you very much. I did what was required of me. It was a boon for me to get that part, which opened my mind to Urdu poetry to begin with and Urdu literature after that. It was an education I badly needed and it just fell into my lap, and I can never be grateful enough to Gulzar Bhai for casting me.
Your struggles and your failures or initial dejection that you felt, and then later in an interview also read where you say that there's nothing worse than being a failed actor. What is failure of an actor?
It's an actor who gives up hope. And if you study the cases of successful actors, there's seldom two cases which have anything in common. The one thing they do have in common is perseverance. There are some who get success at 20, some who get success at 30, some at 40, some at 50, and some even later than that. And you know the examples I'm talking about, there are plenty. A failed actor is an actor who gives up hope. And that is why what I advise young actors who come to me and say, tell us what we should do, I tell them that there is nothing, absolutely nothing that you can do apart from improve yourself. And I don't have the answer to what I mean by improve yourself. You should know what kind of actor you want to become and start working on it. That's what I did. There was nobody to guide me. And ask yourself an important question and answer it honestly. And the question is, would you rather die than not act? And if the answer is yes, only then opt for this work, because it feels personal. It's not as if you're peddling something. You're not selling a product. There's no commodity. There's no... It's you that is being accepted or rejected. And that's very hurtful. The humiliations are very, very deep, and they stay with you for a very long time. So unless you have this completely insane conviction, I was born to do this. And if you believe you've been born to do this, there's nothing that can prevent you from working at yourself. And you'll find what to work at. In fact, in the days when I was jobless, and I was sitting in my little bag, not knowing where my next meal was going to come from, and wondering whether I would get cast in this or cast in that, and I would... The word would come, no, we found somebody else, I'd say, with you, you're going to do it.
I'm sure they do. On the same lines, as you said, that there are impressions and there are memories, and you're not even aware of the fact of what is going into that process which makes a character for an actor. There's such vivid and delicious description of your family members and your marbles. I mean, they look like these Marlboro men, and their hats and their waistcoats. And somehow I couldn't resist but thinking, boy, boy, and I don't know if Three Day is somewhere. It's one of my favorite films, by the
way.
Really? It is. I enjoyed it thoroughly.
It takes all sorts of work. It's not about climbing the trees, but the fact is it prolonged my career by 10 years. It happened at a time when I thought I was going to have to pack up and go back to Mira, because I wasn't getting any work. There were the films I had appeared in were flopping massively, and I was being roasted by all the critics who had hated me a few years earlier. And suddenly I was this terribly awkward person who couldn't dance a step. So Three Day, and again I have no clue why I was cast in that. I think there was no one else. He probably went to every other actor in town, and they all said no. And he cast me, and lo and behold, I have people going away, away to me on the street lights. Till today, it's been 25 years since that movie. So I'm grateful to it. Though frankly, I have never quite understood why I'm cast in those popular movies. It's a bit of a mystery. And I've never been able to quite crack the the technique of acting in one of those films. And I know a lot of actors who can do that stuff very well. I just can't.
Audiences here completely overshadowed Sunny Deol and Black Rock by the stars. I suddenly remember my school friends and I putting on the video and doing the entire choreography as the song.
It was because it was a surprise for the audience. That's what happened actually. They realized, they said, hey, this guy's not such a dullard after all. He can shake a leg. That was the reason. After 3 Day, when there were a few other movies like Chamatkar and so on, which did pretty well at the box office, and I used to be accosted by fans who would say, "Aap ye film mein kyun karte hain?" To main puchta tha, "Aapne Paar dekhi?" Nahi, nahi woh. "Aapne Pestanji dekhi?" Pestanji, nahi woh. "Aapne Manthan dekhi?" Nahi woh tha. आपने चमत्कार जरूर देखी होगी, इतनी देर जरूर देखी होगी, और फिर भी आप मुझसे पूछ रहे हैं कि आप क्यों करते हैं ये फिल्म. सो आई गॉट द हिंट दैट यू नो मे बी आई एम नॉट क्वाइट सूटेड टू दोज मूवीज. बट इट वाज दिस वाज अ स्ट्रेंज थिंग दैट वुड हैपन टू मी अ लॉट ऑफ द टाइम. बट आई एम लुकिंग ओ आपकी आर्टिस्टिक फिल्म. आई थिंक पीपल यू नो द ऑडियंस हु इज नॉट डिसर्निंग रियली फील्स द नीड टू से समथिंग टू यू व्हेन दे एनकाउंटर यू. Anything you want to do, you know. आप तो बहुत बुरे हो गए हैं. आप तो बहुत शॉर्ट हैं. हम तो एक्सपेक्ट कर रहे थे बहुत लंबा चौड़ा. क्या आप तो बहुत हैंडसम है जी. हम तो बहुत बड़ा. आपके फिल्मों में तो आप बड़े बच्चे कर लगते हैं. All the other way around.
Not just the films, but also the characters. And so I'm going to ask you one by one, just briefly, if you can share some impressions or memories of those films or those particular characters. And first, of course, also my favorite of all time is Masoom and DK Malhotra.
Yeah, that was one of the first movies I did where I wasn't asked to play a character. Shekhar told me that I don't want a character, I want you. So, don't think about how he walks and how he sits and how he dresses. I want the way you behave. And that was a very, it was such a, like a weight off my mind. Because before that I'd always played a mad Raja or a passionate Pathan or a fundamentalist Pandit or something like that, where I had to sit and think, where do I find this person inside me? A fundamentalist Brahmin from Karnataka. Where do I find? It was easy to find the rebellious Pathan in 1857, but finding this Pandit guy was tough. But I found him. He's there somewhere. And here, Shekhar just said, just relax and be yourself. And it was the first movie where I worked with children, and for the first time I made friends with children. And to me, that made the experience very, very precious. Apart from the fact that I think it's a wonderfully made movie, it is, in my opinion, I rate it among the best 4 or 5 Hindi films ever made.
Second one, not only for its story and its performances, but also particularly for its music, was Ijazat.
I may disappoint you all, but Ijazat is not one of my favorites. It's a bit too sentimental for me. Gulzar Bhai is very upset with me when I tell him this, but the fact is I much prefer his earlier movies. There was a wonderful movie he made called Libas, which was never released. Great tragedy, I think probably his best movie. I love his movies, the ones he made before, Achanak, Mere Apne, and the one which was like Sound of Music. And his film on Mira also, that was wonderful. I found Ijazat a little bit indulgent. I know it makes all the ladies cry, so please don't hold this against me.
बहुत ही सेंटिमेंटल फिल्म बना रहे हैं जिस तरह आपने किताब भी लिखी. तो तीसरे आपने थोड़ा सा उसके बारे में बात तो की थी बट थोड़ा सा और
अगर
वाले
When I was a child, we had a relative who lived in Gali Kasanjan in Ballimara. We used to come back from Nainital, get off the train in Delhi, old Delhi, be received by our parents, and we used to be taken straight to Gali Kasanjan to stay the day there until we got the train for Ajmer. Or, पता नहीं क्यों मुझे हर बार ये बात बताई जाती थी जब हम वहाँ जाते थे दांगे में या रिक्शा में कि ये मिर्जा आलिम का घर है वहाँ बड़े शायर थे और वहाँ कोई नहीं की टाल थी मुझे अभी भी याद है और मैं सोचता था कि ये बात मुझे क्यों बताई जाती है कि ये मिर्जा आलिम का घर है. कई साल लगे इस बात को समझने में कि ये बात मुझे क्यों बताई जाती थी. स्कूल के दौरान मुझे गालिब का एक शेर याद था जो शायद गालिब का लिखा हुआ ही नहीं है जो हम लोग सब आपस में दोहराते थे इस महफिल में नहीं दोहराया जा सकता. और भारत भूषण साहब की सौरभ गांधी साहब की फिल्म मिर्जा गालिब देखी थी जिस 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 के स्क्रिप्ट में मनपुर साहब का भी हाथ था. बड़ी अच्छी लगी थी मुझे उस वक्त और भारत भूषण साहब को ही मिर्जा गालिब समझा जाता था उन लोगों. कहीं मैंने बहुत बड़ी डिसर्विस की है भारत भूषण साहब के साथ लेकिन उनके हिस्से में बैजू बाबरा और सोनी महिवाल भी आए थे मेरे हिस्से में वो भी आए थे. और फिर ये खबर फैली जब मैं फिल्म इंस्टीट्यूट में था कि मिर्जा गालिब पे फिल्म बनने वाली है जो गुलजार साहब बना रहे हैं और संजीव कुमार को वो मिर्जा गालिब के रोल में कास्ट करना चाहते हैं. मुझे बहुत गुस्सा आया सुनकर. संजीव कुमार साहब बहुत अच्छे एक्टर थे जब तक इस जमाने की बात है वो काफी कॉम्प्लेसेंट हो चुके थे और अपने आप से बेहद खुश होते थे. वो अपनी पीठ इतने थपथपाते थे कि उनका पोस्टर बिगड़ गया था. और मुझे लगता कि गुलजार भाई ये बहुत ही डिजास्टर्स किस्म की गलती कर रहे हैं संजीव कुमार को लेकर. हालांकि संजीव कुमार गुलजार भाई के चहेते एक्टर थे अक्सर उनकी फिल्मों में काम किया करते थे. तो मैंने खत लिखा गुलजार भाई कि आप ये बहुत बड़ी गलती कर रहे हैं और मेरा नाम नसीरुद्दीन शाह है. मैं मेरठ का रहने वाला हूँ जहाँ से गालिब साहब की शराब आती थी जो कि बात सच थी और मैं गली कासिमजान में रहा हूँ जो कि बात आधी सच थी और मैं गालिब साहब की शायरी से पूरी तरह वाकिफ हूँ जो कि बात बिल्कुल झूठ थी. वो खत उन्हें मिला ही नहीं कई साल बीत गए जब तक मैं ये सवाल उनसे पूछ सका. हुआ ये कि संजीव कुमार साहब बीमार पड़ गए और उन्हें बहुत ज़्यादा दिलचस्पी भी नहीं थी गालिब में ऐसा गुजार था मुझे बताया. फिर वो शायद बच्चन साहब के साथ बनाना चाह रहे थे एज ए फिल्म नहीं बन पाई तो बस मेरे नसीब में थी. जब ये टीवी सीरियल बना तो मेरे ख्याल से मैं आखिरी फेवरेट था इस लोगों के लिए और मुझसे शायराना मिजाज के बहुत सारे लोग थे फारूक शेख वरुण पंकज कपूर जैसे और भी कई लोग थे. और मैं इसीलिए जब मेरी इतनी तारीफ होती है इतनी दुआएं मिलती हैं मुझे मैं हज़ार दफ़ा शुक्रगुजार हूँ इस बात का लेकिन मैं उसका क्रेडिट रत्ती भर भी नहीं लेता क्योंकि उसकी लिखाई इतनी बेहतरीन थी कि कोई भी काबिल एक्टर रोल रोल करता. अगर पंकज कपूर या फारूक शेख इन दोनों में से कोई भी गालिब की भूमिका करता मेरे ख्याल से वो उतनी ही कामयाब होती. बस मेरी किस्मत में थी जो मुझे मिल गई. मेरा जीना हराम कर दिया था और मैं उम्मीद करता हूँ कि 15 साल बाद जब मैं पूरा 80 साल का हो चुका हूँ एक और गाना है सामने
audience is really trying to sabotage and take over. So to quote in the same context, this another brilliant quote where you say that a bad audience can be turned into a good one. How is that possible? It's a very good audience, I must say.
It's a good one. No, see, there is no such thing as a bad audience because nobody has come to watch your performance with the intention of rejecting it. Unless you're doing an intercollegiate drama competition or something. Which I've been fortunate enough never to do. But anybody who takes the trouble to travel an hour and a half through the terrible traffic to come and watch you perform has not come there to, you know, to write you off. There are such things, and there are easier and more difficult audiences, but I really believe that even a hostile audience can be won over by the quality of the work. It's the work they've come there to see. They've not come there because of you. And if they've come there because of you, you've got to divert their attention from yourself to the work you're doing. And that's important. And if you can manage to do that, then I think you achieve that blissful state of contact with every single person who's present. And when a play is going wonderfully well, and it happens in every play, in fleeting moments, that you genuinely feel in complete contact with every single person present, when that doesn't happen, the audience gets turned off. I suppose the audience gets bored. They get restive because there's something wrong with your performance. They have not come there to get restive. That's what happens.
And so talking about the power of theatre in another context, you also mentioned something like that it's not only the movie camera which can bring itself or the audience in turn close to the actor's eyes or expressions. Sure. Even in theatre you believe that an audience has that capacity or vice versa, like an actor has that potential.
It's a 50-50 thing. The audience has to have the ability to focus and you've got to have the ability to get them to focus. You don't need the only audiences in the first row to be able to see your eyes. And in fact, even in a large hall like this, or even larger, when you are being focused on completely, you can see the actor's eyes, you can see the look on his face. And it's your entire body which expresses. The audience doesn't really need to see every wrinkle of your face. They read your mind, and that's when it really, that the contact really occurs. There's a lot of this nonsense that's talked about on the stage. You have to enlarge your performance and you have to be heard in the last row. You have to be heard in the first row as well, equally. If you're concentrating on the guy in the last row, the person in the first row is going to go deaf. Everybody has to receive the performance in the same manner, I believe, and it really is possible. Really is possible. And an audience which has come there to watch you can easily be turned into a bad audience if you commit the most elementary mistakes. And we see that a lot of the time. The most elementary mistakes.
बेटा आपको अम्मी ज़्यादा अच्छी लगती हैं आपको सो मैं उस किस्म का ही एक फजूल सवाल कर रही हूँ थिएटर या फिल्म
अगर कोई मुझे बंदूक मेरे सर पे रख के कहे कि तुम्हें चॉइस करना ही पड़ेगा तो शायद मैं थिएटर चुनूँ अगर मेरे सर पे बंदूक रख के कोई मुझसे ये कहे तो I think that through living exchange of energies jo hoti hai theater mein, it is untranslatable, it is not capturable. And isliye main khilaf hoon अपने ड्रामों को फिल्माने के. I don't even like them to be videoed and shown, because no camera can capture the kind of exchange of energies which occurs. The audience in a play is not incidental. They are essential. They are part of the play, and they transmit an energy which infects the actor, and vice versa. So it is really a living medium. जब आप फिल्मों में काम कर रहे होते हैं, you have to communicate with the camera. Camera is not a human being. Contact with the camera is not the same thing as contact with another human being. But you have to learn how to make contact with that camera if you want to be a good film actor. So I would say all in all, theatre is more enjoyable. Everybody's pulling together. We are all working as a team, whether you are playing the lead, or whether you are working backstage, or whether you are doing the costume or the sets. Sab saath baithte hain, sab saath khate hain, sab saath kaam karte hain, sab saath haste hain, sab saath rote hain. You never get that experience in a movie. The actor is isolated completely in a movie. He sits in his air-conditioned cocoon, comes out and gives the shot and goes back into his air-conditioned cocoon. I find theatre more alive. So much, and it has the ability to captivate you completely, and you can make very important statements through films. And let me also clarify that I am not against entertainment cinema at all. I love entertaining movies, and I do not believe in boring philosophies being propounded through movies which you cannot sit through. I believe in entertainment as well, but I believe cinema can do more than just entertainment and can inform. I don't think it can change people's lives. Maybe documentaries can. I consider documentaries the more important form of cinema.
Shah Saab ki ijazat se, on the note of his love for theatre, one of the most beautiful things that I came across in the works of this little paragraph, if I may.
Sure.
Now I was actually standing behind the curtain. I was there. I took a long while savoring the feeling that there were people out there who were curious about what we were doing, about what I was doing. I kicked the hem of the curtain to make it billow and make them wonder even more. That's what the inside of a mother's womb must feel like, warm, safe, comfortable. This is a child standing backstage in a school.
Experience of my life. Just to explain a little bit, I was a poor student, I was a lonely child, I had no friends, I was not popular, I was not good at anything. The only thing I loved doing was reading the literature that we studied in class or watching movies and plays. We saw a lot of movies, we also did a number of plays. Groups from outside also would come and perform there. To me, that was pure magic. And this was a description of the first time I decided to go on stage. Myself for the first time. I got a group of friends together and we did this little skit. And after what Sarmad has just read out, the curtain opened and I was quite unprepared for the intensity of the lighting in which I was standing. I was blinded completely. But after a few seconds, my eyes began to focus, and very hesitantly, I was a kid who could not speak much. I was afflicted with a stammer. I was afflicted with complete, you know, low self-esteem and all that. But I spoke this first line, and I felt a response from the very people who had been judgmental about me and who had not given me the time of day. It was a life-changing experience for me. That was the moment I realized this is where I belong, and this is where I'm going to stay for the rest of my life.
Lastly, a big fat slobbery kiss to the jewel of my existence, Ratna. queen of her species, who while doing so much else has also steadfastly, through thick and thin, better and worse, for richer and for poorer, in sickness and in health, held my hand and propped me up for well nigh 40 years. May her thrive in peace.
There is something which, you know, there was a film I did called Spush, which is one of my favorites, and I was in Delhi shooting this film, and it was a most wonderful experience to shoot this film, and I think it's one of my more successful performances. It was a really an eye-opening experience. So let me read you a few things I've written about that. On first hearing the script, incidentally, this was another part which had been offered to Mr. Sanjeev Kumar, and he turned it down. There you are. That's why he could not have played his part. On first hearing the script, I knew how I was definitely not going to play the part. The way it always is in Hindi movies, eyes fixed in a frontal gaze, stumbling around, arms outstretched, bumping into walls, referring to oneself as Main Bichara, Lachara, and such nonsense. The script did not require me to do that anyway, and say, lesser forbade me from wearing dark glasses. And she told me that Mr. Mittal has the most beautiful eyes I've ever seen. Mr. Mittal was the character on whom, the person on whom the character I was playing was based. He was actually the principal of the school, completely sightless himself, and had been in love with this sighted lady and had gotten into a lot of trouble. Okay. All right. So I had also keenly observed a few sightless people, including my grand aunt, Nani Baji. She was called the great storyteller, and two classmates in Aligarh, because I found their physical manner intriguing. I had by now figured out that the key to it was that sightless people direct their ears and not their eyes at the point they are addressing. And that causes the sometimes ungainly bodily postures, which having absolutely no self-consciousness, they are quite oblivious to. I also spent quite some time watching Mr. Mittal operate, chatting with him, and found that sightless people use the verb to see quite freely and in the same sense as the rest of us. The day before the shooting began, Mr. Mittal and I spent a most entertaining and educative evening with a friend of his, a Mr. Advani, also sightless, and an undersecretary in the Ministry of Education, who had invited us to dinner. After inquiring, we were all sitting around and there was a buffet kind of dinner, so I asked Mr. Mittal what he would like to have, and I served him on a plate and offered it to him after placing a fork on it. He accepted the plate but didn't start eating with the rest of us, nor did he respond to my puzzled inquiries. He just sat there with the plate until his fiancée, who was a little late, arrived and replaced the fork with a spoon. It turned out sightless people never use forks. It also turned out, sightless people can thoroughly enjoy a drink. They do have dreams. They have a concept of the primary colors. They never keep pets. And I asked Advani Sahib why, because I was thinking of having a cat or something. And he said, "Nahi, kabhi nahi hoga." But I said, "Kyun?" He said, "Pair ke niche aa jayega." And they possess a sense that operates above the waist, only above the waist, which is why they do not bump into lampposts or trees, but do trip over low-lying objects. Post-dinner, we were heading down the steps when a power failure turned everything pitch black. Mr. Mittal was leading the way. We all stopped dead in our tracks, and he turned around and inquired why we had stopped. And when he told him why, he continued down the steps, chuckling, "Well, follow me then."
The book sort of stops in the early 80s. Is there going to be a second volume?
See, I mustn't push my luck too far. The critics have been very kind. And all my friends have been also very encouraging, and I don't think I should. I might just get roasted if I write another book. This took me 12 years to write. I really don't know. I think I've covered what could be called the most interesting part of my life. After that, it was more or less smooth sailing. I don't know, really. I don't think so.
Well, I think that it is 6 o'clock and time is up. So thank you very much for coming, but more than you people, thank you so much for being here.